What is up, weather enthusiasts? I'm your host, Pat's Path Predictor. Let's get right into the weather. And tonight, we have a very special edition of Pat's Path Predictor. We have a very special guest who is coming on for an interview. This is WxCenter Nazario coming in right now. How are you doing, sir?
Very good, very good. Happy Halloween to everyone tuning in as well. Hope that things are all great in your neck of the woods.
Yes, happy Halloween as well. Unfortunately, it's not such a good Halloween. We have had some pretty crazy weather across not only the Caribbean, but the United States. We're actually getting snow in the Chicago area, as a matter of fact, on Halloween, which is pretty crazy. But we also have an invest that we need to talk about, which is Invest 97L. And this kind of brings up my first question. What's your take on this invest? We've been seeing an up and down ebb and flow situation from last night that I've noticed, at least from the satellite imagery.
Oh, yeah, definitely. This thing has been very, very erroneous to track. I do believe the computer models have been having a very hard time trying to get an idea of exactly what's going to take place over the next few days, let alone the next 5 to 7 days, for that matter. It's honestly had all of us working overtime, especially here in the Weather Center. I've been obsessing over every possible detail that could possibly, you know, inhibit this thing from getting itself going. Especially when the GFS had such great run-to-run consistency last week. Honestly, I'm sure you'll agree, we haven't really seen the GFS have such good run-to-run consistency or initialize that well run-to-run pretty much throughout the entire hurricane season, especially even with our continuity runs of 6 and 18Z, because right. We all know very well that those are typically the runs where we do get the most bizarre Category 5 hitting the Gulf Coast or Category 5 into... Yep. South America, you know, one way or another. So it's been tricky. It's probably got like the best favorable environment out ahead of it, yet it just doesn't seem like it wants to execute any kind of development.
Yeah, for now it seems. That actually brings up my next question. There seems to be a disconnect between the models and the conditions. You were kind of touching up on that a little bit, but based on of the conditions that you're seeing, what do you have to say about this? Should people be overly concerned right now? Because I get a lot of comments asking me, hey, should I be worried about this? Should I prepare? What should I do?
So, you know, for the time being, I mentioned this, I believe, in a live stream yesterday, as well as in a video segment I filmed earlier today. And at this point in time, based on what we're seeing, not only with intensity guidance, with how wishy-washy our main models and our tropical models are being, one thing is for certain, we can anticipate that whatever this thing decides to remain as or become, it'll be pushing towards Central America first, Nicaragua, Honduras, potentially El Salvador if it decides to plunge straight through CENTAM, and Belize, the islands just off the coast of Belize could definitely see some impacts as well with that northward jog, a few of the intensity, or I should say the track guidance have indicated. So that general region should definitely be on alert. They should have a preparation plan in place just to be on the safe side, because whether or not this thing does organize and get a name, it's still going to create a lot of catastrophic potential flooding, which is obviously we know is not what they need right there. They've already had a lot of Central American gyre flooding going on, consistent thunderstorm activity for what felt like most of September and into October. So the last thing they need, even if it stays weak, is another hefty rainmaker. For the rest of us out there, Jamaica, Cayman Islands, Cuba, all the way up into the southeast U.S., I know Florida was under the gun, same with the Bahamas for a little bit. I would say we can just continue to kind of watch and wait and see if this thing decides to organize, because if it doesn't, we can pretty much move or remove any sort of northward jog from possibilities altogether.
All right, thank you very much. So I have right now pulled up the track models and the intensity models at this current point. There's been, we've been talking about this, there's a huge disconnect. And we also have a huge variety of scenarios that are going to happen. For example, the HWRF and the HMON earlier today were indicating potentially Category 2 or Category 3 scenarios going into towards Nicaragua. So I wanted to pass this off to you. In your opinion, what is the most likely scenario we get out of this?
For the time being, man, that's one of the best questions I've been asked in a while, truthfully. My preliminary forecasts were definitely on more of the side of we could at least get a high-end tropical storm hurricane out of this.
Right.
I still think that is definitely on the table, especially as we roll forward in time, we can get ahead of that shear that's on the eastern quadrant of that anti-cyclone out there in the Caribbean. It goes without saying, we've been talking OHC, sea surface temps, all season long. That area has not been touched by a significant cyclone all hurricane season whatsoever. Even Idalia really did much, little to nothing in terms of OHC towards the Western Caribbean.
Yeah.
And on top of that, we've had such tremendous amounts of moist air advection and just an overall increase in relative humidity, not only brought on by that high height center, but just in general, they've had copious amounts of thunderstorm activity down there. Now the dry air that has been affecting us here in the States has made it that far to the south. So it's in essence like a breeding ground for tropical activity, which is why it's so stunning to see the models really don't want to do anything with it. Even the GFS, who went fully gung-ho calling for a major hurricane as we approach the first weekend of November. So, I mean, I would definitely suggest we continue to monitor. Tropical storm low-end hurricane is not off the table, especially once it does decide to park itself under that anticyclonic flow and tap into that environment source region. But for the time being, that's tough. I really don't know if we're going to organize anything over the next 24, maybe even the next 48, 72 hours for that matter.
Okay, just a bit of a side quest a little bit, because I'm pulling, because right now I have pulled up on my screen the ocean heat content values, which are still, for the Caribbean, incredibly rather impressive. And so where this thing is right now, it's in an area of, I'd say, about 100 to 125 OHC. Could you explain to the viewers just how much fuel is in the Caribbean for, like, something, if it were to happen, to happen?
Oh, Lord, yeah, absolutely. You know, without using a whole lot of sophisticated jargon, as I'll call it, that is essentially what a lot of us like to say, jet fuel, in essence. That is like fuel to the flame, if you will. Any kind of organized or consolidated disturbance out there with really good levels of shear in the upper levels and the ample moisture we have down there is really, it's ready to explode, truthfully. It'll blow its top very quickly. I'm not going to compare it to the likes of Hurricane Lee out in the Central Atlantic earlier this hurricane season. I don't want to make any comparisons to what we've seen in the Eastern Pacific, but, you know, climatology has served us well, and we've seen plenty of instances where when conditions are just right, these storms can really intensify fast. And with the just the absurd level of OHC and sea surface temps combined, for that matter, it's ridiculous what a truly organized and strengthening system could possibly do out there.
Yeah.
In layman's terms, it could be worst case scenario. Are we saying that's going to happen now? You know, surprisingly, it doesn't look like it's going to exploit all that, but, you know, it's still there. You know, at least got to give it that 5% chance.
Yeah, of course. So now that you were talking about the OHC, we've been talking so much on this channel, and even when Idalia and Lee were happening, Lee, like you just mentioned, models are one thing, but conditions are another ballpark. And some of the conditions I'm noting here, and I have them pulled up, we're looking at 30 degrees Celsius or 86 degrees Fahrenheit waters. We're looking at wind shear ahead of it about 10 to 15 knots or so, and we just talked about the OHC. What do you think about all of this, first of all? And we were talking about earlier about maybe the shear on the back end maybe causing some issues. Could you kind of explain that a little bit?
Yeah, so it kind of looks like something that we may have missed or something that may have worked its way around the backside of that anticyclone tucked in across the Caribbean Sea. It may actually be helping to shear apart that thunderstorm activity that really had itself together last night. We were looking at it on my APM Tropics talk, and that storm looked like it was ready to go depression in the next 24 hours. But as soon as that weak channel, I shouldn't even say weak, as soon as that channel and that thin band of upper level shear came down, the system essentially wiped itself out. And I still believe once we can get out ahead of it, if we can retain a little bit of the convection that's still trying to hang on out there and get into the Central Caribbean, probably somewhere between, you know, southeast of the Cayman Islands, south of Jamaica, I'm trying to reference a map in my mind right now, that's where I think it'll have the best opportunity to start taking advantage of having such favorable conditions at all levels, not only below it, but above it and within it, if that makes sense, when you think about it three-dimensionally. It's remarkable to see that none of our models, especially the GFS, they've all lost confidence in it. Our halves A and B are not doing anything with it right now because they can't find that closed circulation. H-Wharf, a lot of people tend to discredit it because it is technically, quote, obsolete. I still think it's done decent with some of the other storms we've had this year and last, but, you know, that remains to be seen. Right now we have the H-Mod and the H-Wharf who still actually want to intensify this. The halves models are looking very minuscule. We have none of our main models we love to talk about in our channels whatsoever trying to get any sort of emphasis on this. So, you know, I still think it's on the table. We've seen a lot of underforecasting this year. Maybe they're taking into account the climatological norms, as well as the fact that we should be in a textbook El Nino right now. And maybe that's why they're thinking there is no chance this thing has to survive once it continues to move to the west. So it's definitely going to be a case of computer models versus human involvement.
Pretty much. Okay. So my next question for you is, let's say this thing really does start to get its act together. Let's say this thing really starts to organize and potentially intensify. What should people be doing to prepare for this, especially in Nicaragua and Honduras, which are rather mountainous countries that are prone to potential flash flooding, especially?
Of course. So it may sound a little on the sensationalist side, but the way I like to describe it, especially when talking the difference between forecasting and what a lot of people tend to neglect now casting, you know, right. Before a system is highlighted by National Hurricane Center, before we are within the 3 to 5 day threshold of something coming your way, I've seen you do it on your channel, which is great. I've seen a few others do it on their channels, and they kind of go through the trenches of being highlighted as, oh, you're just trying to hype up something. But that's truly the name of the game. You want to start informing people of the possibilities before the possibility becomes a reality. And now next thing you know, you have a disturbance or, God forbid, a hurricane sneaking up on your back doorstep, because that's the time you want to take to at least dust off your preparation plans. Take a quick look around the house, kind of assess who it is you may need to contact, have a good escape plan if, God forbid, you do have to evacuate. If you live along a coastal area, somewhere prone to really good inundation from floodwaters, mudslides, especially for our mountainous areas, you know, you should take the calm before the storm arrives. Literally, in terms of before it's even on satellite headed your way, to at least double check and do a sanity check that if I do have to prepare, how much preparing am I going to have to do? Or is it going to be a mad rush, like, you know, waiting until 2 days before the first day of school to get yourself ready with your textbooks and your book bag and so on and so forth? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean about that.
So, yeah, I mean, right now, that's my best, you know, kind of advice for everybody out there in Central America. Just have your preparedness set up, ready to rock and roll. If it does intensify, understand how to kind of incrementally increase how prepared you are. If you got to hunker down and shelter in place or kind of get out of the way, you know, have these options on hand to where if it does come time and you're 24 hours out from a landfall, you're not sort of scrambling and asking, what do I do? How do I get around this? You know what I mean?
Yeah, unfortunately, we saw that with Otis just a little bit ago.
Big time.
Yeah. All right. WxCenter Nazario, thank you for coming on for the interview. We appreciate you taking the time to kind of explain the more technical and dynamical side of things. So,
absolutely.
Yeah, we really appreciate that. Ladies and gentlemen, that is going to be it for the interview tonight. I really hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe to WxCenter Nazario. He's been making awesome content over the last few months. I shouted him out when he just started, and now he's over 5,000 subscribers and growing every single day. If you give him a few more subs, I'm sure he'd really appreciate that. But with that being said, we're going to go ahead and close the video out right here. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to leave a like and subscribe to the channel if you're new. The goal of this channel is, as always, to get more people engaged with weather, as well as to talk to others and get their opinions. But with that being said, have a wonderful day, guys. Stay safe.